Hello, it's Keith here, and this is a special episode in which I'm going to be discussing the Sega Master System and Game Gear. Now, we're going to look at these from the point of view of a programmer who's only worked on computers like the Amstrad and the Spectrum before. We're going to have a look at the hardware and discuss what it actually takes to program it, and then what we need to learn that's different compared to the systems we're used to. Now, firstly, I have to apologise. I said I was going to teach the Game Boy this week. I've decided to do the Game Gear and the Master System first. The reason for that is the Game Boy and the Game Gear have some things in common, but the Game Boy is more different than the Game Gear to these systems like the Amstrad CPC, and the main reason for that is it has a different processor. The Game Boy isn't a true Z80 processor. The Master System and the Game Gear are a true Z80 processor, so there is more in common with the systems we're used to. So we're going to cover the Game Boy next week, but if you are only interested in the Game Boy, I'd recommend you keep watching anyway, because I'm going to cover in more detail in this lesson some of the concepts that are common to both the Game Boy and the Master System and the Game Gear. So anyway, so let's start on the Master System and the Game Gear. Now, the first important thing to know about the Master System and the Game Gear is they're actually almost the exactly same console. The Game Gear is basically a Master System with a slightly smaller screen and rather strangely a better palette. So the Game Gear, if you ignore the screen size, is actually superior to the Master System. And that's why there is a converter for the Game Gear to plug Master System cartridges into the Game Gear, but there is no Master System cartridges to play Game Gear games because the Master System is actually slightly inferior, but it's only the screen colour palette that's different. So let's have a look at the hardware. Well, as I just said, it is a true Z80 processor, so anything you do on your regular Z80, you can do on this. There's no registers missing, there's no commands missing. You can use your interrupt modes exactly as you want. It's all fine. We've only got 8 kilobytes of RAM, so we do have to make some programming changes. We can't treat it like the 64K systems, so self-modifying code is going to be mostly out of the window. We have to put all of our variables into one common pool of area. Now, we've got 16K of video RAM, and the video RAM is very similar and actually based on the MSX1's video memory. Now, we've not really covered the MSX1 yet, so we're going to cover it later, but we're going to be kind of covering some new territory with that. But basically, we have to work with it without commands, unlike the bitmap memory of the other systems we've usually looked at. So as I just said, the screen is a different size. It's 256 by 192 on the Master System, which is the same as the MSX. On the Game Gear, it's slightly smaller, 160 by 144. We'll have a look at that in a moment. Now, this is the next important thing we're going to discuss, and this is the real important thing to understand about the Game Gear, the Master System, and the Game Boys. They work in tiles and sprites. We're going to discuss these in detail in a moment, but if you're not familiar with them, there are basically two layers. The first one is a tile array, which fills the screen, and then on top of that is a sprite layer. So the tile array is made up of up to 512 different tiles. Now, the problem on the Master System is there are 768 tiles for one screen. So that means there has to be some duplication on the screen. We're going to cover this in a moment, though, so we'll just skip over that for now. The Game Gear has the same number of tile capability, but because the screen's smaller, we can actually have one different tile for every space on the screen. Now, with regards to sprites, the system is limited to... The sprites are 8 by 8 pixels, and it's limited to being able to draw 8 on a single line. And there's also a limit that it can only store 64 on a screen. But the 64 on the screen is overridden by the 8 on the line. So if you put all 64 on the same line, only 8 of them are going to show properly, and you'll find some of them will have bits missing or flicker. This is a common limitation among hardware, and it's especially serious among 8-bit systems. If you've ever seen the games like Ninja Turtles on the Nintendo NES, if all of the enemies lined up with the player, bits of them would start to flicker, and that's because of the line limits of the hardware. The hardware is physically only capable of drawing that many sprites on a line, and as soon as more of the virtual sprites go on the same line, the hardware simply can't cope, and usually they compensate by flickering some of them on or off. Now, the colours. Both systems are capable of 32 on screen. That's one palette for the sprites and one palette for the tiles. But the palette of the Master System is only 64 colours, whereas on the Game Gear it's 4096. So we've got more choice on the Game Gear. But when we come to discussing the palette, I've actually got some conversion code, which will convert the CPC plus format colours to whatever system we're working on. So we can work with both systems in a common way. Now, there are various sound chips options, but the primary common sound chip is the SN76489. We will be discussing that in a later lesson. And rather strangely, they have slightly different controls. The Master System has two controllers, up, down, left, right, and two fire buttons. The Game Gear only has one controller, up, down, left, right, fire, and start. So an extra button on the Game Gear. But apart from that, they're basically the same. So let's go back to this concept of tiles and sprites. Well, if you think of your average game like your Super Mario type game, and I've drawn a little sort of sample one here, you'll have your playing character here, you'll have some kind of floor, maybe some objects you have to climb or jump over, and some collectible items maybe like these stars. And if you've never programmed these kind of systems before, maybe never thought about it before, you probably haven't really, it hasn't really occurred to you how this all would work. And the important thing is what we sort of said before, the system can only do 8x8 pixel sprites, and it can only do 8 on a line, whereas the tile array will cover the entire screen. And so what actually happens is the graphics you see on the screen are made up of two separate layers. Now the top layer usually will be the sprite layer, and in this case I've drawn the playing character here as sprites, and so this character would be made up of multiple sprites, and we'll have a look at that in a moment. But then behind that will be the tile layer. Now the important difference between the sprite layer and the tile layer is the layout. The tiles are in a grid, so each tile is 8x8 pixels, and you can't have a tile halfway, you can't have one tile crossing a border. You can maybe scroll the tiles so that the leftmost tile is half on the screen and the rightmost tile is half on the screen, but the tiles compared to each other are always in this grid layout. And then the next thing to understand is each tile has a number, and on the Game Gear we've got 512 tiles. So what that means is the first tile will be 0 and the last tile will be 511. And we define these 8x8 graphics as tile patterns, they're sometimes called. And then in the tile map, we then point to those patterns. So for example, this star might be saved as pattern 3. And then in the tile map, if we put this 3 here, and this 3 here, and this 3 here, these three locations will show the same pattern. And as I said before, this is important, especially on the Master System. The Master System screen would be made up of 768 patterns, but we can only show 512. And that means there has to be some duplication. If the Master System was capable of showing 768 patterns on the 768 screen, we could treat it as a fake bitmap if we wanted. But that's not going to be possible because of the screen limitations. We're going to have to work within this tile sprite concept. So it is important you understand it. And if you look, I've got some examples here on the Game Gear and the Master System. And as I said, these are actually the same example. It's the same code, and the only difference is the top corner of the screen has been offset slightly for the Game Gear version, and that's because of the screen layout, and the palette has been defined in a different way, but the rest of the code is identical. Now, I've defined tiles for all of the letters, and also I've drawn tiles onto this area here, and then I've filled in the Chibico bitmap for the tiles that are drawn here. And the rest of this area here is all tile 0, which is the space. And so that's how I've managed to sort of fake a bitmap on the screen. It's actually a set of tiles. There's no sprites being used here. But anyway, so the tile map is a bank of memory in the VDP on the Game Gear. And so each position will be consecutive. And so to set a certain tile, we just have to work out its memory location, set it to the number that the tile of the tile that we've defined, and that will have the effect on the screen. And the effect is basically immediate. And this is the thing of the tile maps, they're very, very fast. Because the entire screen is just defined by 768 bytes, you can swap every tile on the screen with very few bytes of poking, whereas on something like an Amstrad CPC where it's 16 kilobytes, that's a huge amount of data area. So while the tile map limits us with regard to how many, with regards to the fact we can't have every tile unique on the screen, it does give us a lot of speed. So it does have its distinct advantages. So with regards to sprites, as I said, a sprite is on these systems is only 8x8 pixels, and that's true on the Game Boy as well. But we can make up a sprite of multiple other sprites. So if you look at this rather excessive example here of the Yume character here, I've sort of drawn this as an 8x8 grid. And so if we wanted to show this at this resolution, we would have to use lots and lots of sprites here. But of course, some of these sprites would actually be entirely black, so we can skip those ones. And on the Game Boy, which is a four-colour system, if we wanted to make the character use 8 colours, we could layer sprites on top of each other. So, as I say, we have to work in the limitations of the hardware, so 8x8 pixel sprites and the tile map has to have some repetition because of the tile number limit, but we can use those work around those limitations by merging sprites together, using simulating sprites with tiles, because these stars don't need to be sprites. Even if they animate, they can just be tiles, and we can just have different tile numbers for the different frames of animation and just swap them over. So we do have to work within the limitations, but those limitations aren't too bad, and the sheer speed of these systems kind of makes up for it. So, as I said, the Game Gear and the Master System are different screen sizes, and although you can see the H is in the top left corner here, and this is the top left corner here, actually this is my code doing the work here. I should say we're going to look at the code that did this work in a later lesson, but this is just an introduction to the concepts of the hardware. So the way the Game Gear works is the screen is actually in the center of the Master System screen, so you're losing basically three lines from the top, three lines from the bottom, and six lines from either side. And so you've got this area in the middle here, and it's actually the same resolution as the Game Boy. So if you want to program for both, that's one benefit for you. As I said, the palette is very different. We only have 2 bits per color on the Master System, but we actually have 4 bits per color on the Game Gear. So much better palette on the Game Gear, and more. It's the same number of colors as the CPC Plus, but the format's slightly different, but not very much. Now, as I've said, the Game Gear and the Master System are a true Z80 processor, so the system memory and the functionality works very much the way you would expect on a Z80. But of course, the important thing to understand with regards to the Game Boy and the Game Gear, and quite probably most other console systems, is they don't have any built-in ROM. Now, on the Amstrad or the Spectrum or any of the systems you're used to, you have this kind of bit of ROM that will do some work for you, draw your text to the screen, read your input for you. But on these systems, you have nothing by default. So you really have to make everything yourself. But that's not a problem for us, because we've been doing that anyway. We've not been relying on the firmware. We've been writing our own modules to do our own work for us anyway. But it does give us the sort of benefit of, whereas before we've had to discuss, well, what RSTs are available to us? Well, now everything's available to us. We really have everything. So, when we create a file for these systems, all we do is we get our assembler to output a binary file. And the first byte in a Master System or Game Gear file is the first byte that will be loaded into memory. So the first 16 kilobytes of that file will be the base quarter of the system memory, which is ROM. And so the first byte will be RST0, and then you'll have all the RSTs, the interrupt handler here on RST7 as usual. And then all we have to bear in mind is there are a few special memory addresses. Now, the Master System and the Game Gear technically should have a header. Strangely enough, it's not at the head of the file. It actually starts at 7FF0, or at least that's one of the memory addresses it can appear at, and that's the normal one. And there's a few things it should have. It should have TMR Sega at this address. It should have a checksum, and it should have product codes and a few other little bits here. I say should have because actually the emulators don't look for it, and they don't check it, and they don't care if it doesn't exist or it's wrong. Strangely enough, the Fusion emulator I'm using, actually look at the file name of the file. If it ends GG, it assumes it's a Game Gear. If it's SMS, it assumes it's a Sega Master System game. So you don't need to worry about getting the checksum right. You don't need to worry about this at all. But that's where it should be, and that's the format it should be in. Now, all of the other space, so between after you RST7 jump block and the header, that space can be used by your game code, but of course it is ROM, so no self-modifying code. And then 8000 to C000, again, you can have all of the ROM code you want in there. And then finally, you've got a chunk of memory here, which is the 8 kilobytes. You do actually have this area, you're actually 16 kilobytes, and the reason for that is the second bank is actually a clone of the same bank. So you can write to this range if you want, but you will be overwriting this. That you're not getting a second bank there. It's just one bank duplicated. And then finally, you have some special registers here. If you write to these, if your ROM file is very large, i.e. over sort of 48 kilobytes, if you write to these, you can bank switch the areas of the ROM in these areas to those extra memory 16K chunks of your ROM file. So if you want a really big 512K ROM, you can switch the extra pages in there, and that works quite nicely too. Now, on the Game Gear and the Master System, you do have a few ports that you can access the hardware with, and the hardware, to be honest, is pretty nice to work with. It's pretty simple. You've got a few ports for reading the joystick. The joystick's very easy to read. It's nowhere near as complex as things like the Spectrum, which have an entire keyboard. We've only really got eight lines for the entire joystick, so very easy to read. We have two ports for the VDP, which is the graphics system. The graphics system is actually a superior version of the MSX1 graphics system, quite substantially superior. But I believe if you actually get MSX1 games, you can copy them straight to the Master System, because the graphics chip is backwards compatible on the Master System and the Game Gear to run the games from the MSX1, although vastly inferior. You got it getting two colours per sprite instead of 16. So whether you'd want to, I don't know, but it is apparently backwards compatible. We're going to discuss the proper capabilities of the hardware, though, in a later lesson. So we have some counters here just to check what the screen's doing if we want to try and get tricky with raster switching. We've got joystick reading, we've got sound chip functions, and that's really about it. So that's, to be honest, all we're going to be covering today. We are going to have a look at this tutorial example here that I'm going to show you in a later lesson. It's a little bit too complex here, but as I say, we are going to cover it. And this example does work on a variety of other systems, so the Game Boy, the Master System, and also the MSX1 and the MSX2, because the tile sprite concept is also true for the MSX1, and it works much more nicely than trying to treat the MSX2 graphics display as a bitmap display as well. So as I say, even beyond the consoles, this tile sprite concept is an important one, and it is beneficial in some cases on the games, on the home computers, to treat those systems as tile sprite. So it's certainly something we'll be looking at in the future. So I hope you've enjoyed today's lesson. We are going to teach the Game Boy next week, I promise. That's about all I wanted to cover today. It was really a very quick introduction to the Master System and the Game Gear, just because I wanted to discuss the differences to what you were used to, and I didn't want to try and jump into code at the same time. So I hope you've enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.